Oh, goodness, all kinds of things are bubbling and boiling up within us this morning. Thank you for the grace that comes when we can laugh together in community, when we can twist into our own understanding a scripture that is age old but still has its messages for us today. As you bring forth this recipe of scripture, oh God, help it to enliven our hearts, to speak truth to our own realities, and to draw us together through the loving spirit of your family. Amen. Amen and amen. I think I was about 12, friends, when I had a novel idea at Christmas. I was tired, I tell you, of the ways I was feeling bullied by my brother. Perhaps some of you can relate out there. We had many people saying firstborn, many saying second or third. We didn't get a good capture on the onlys out there, the single. Yes, yes, those who are the singles of their family. We know that there can be all of this energy, and mine was very intense for a lot of the time. My brother is 5.5 years older. Still is, and he had a custom of doing things that he knew would just drive me bananas. I won't go too far into it, but I will just give you a flavor and an example. He mooned my birthday party, he read my diary, he liked to put me in headlocks, and he was constantly tooting, as a brother likes to do, especially in the car when you're sitting there and you're going along just okay, and then you're smelling something in the car. What is that smell? It's my brother, yes. All of these mounting things caused me to feel the part of the frustrated little sister. He was always miles smarter and physically stronger, and I thought, well, won't it just serve him right to open a box at Christmas and get nothing from me, you know, in this little plotted way of what can I do to get back at him? So I did this. I set about to wrapping and placed a gift under the tree in advance of Christmas. And it days it sat there, right, in advance of it coming. And I thought, okay, well, this is going to be interesting when he opens this box for me, right? And so after I did that, I did have a few misgivings, thinking, okay, how's this going to go? And as we sat there at Christmas, it was interesting because we had each of us received many gifts, and I received one from my brother. It seems sometimes, even though he was nasty a lot of time or found ways of really getting my goat, he did have a gift for me, and as I opened it up, can you imagine as I'm getting this big lump in my throat, because what do I get? But I think some colorful pens or some erasers, the kind of thing that I could really enjoy at that time. So my brother had spent his own money on me. Meanwhile, he hadn't opened my gift yet. I could feel this knot in my stomach growing. It was too late to take it back, and there it was at his side, ready to unwrap. There was this anticipation because I had wrapped it well. And my parents were no doubt thinking, this is great. Claire has gotten her brother something. Maybe the Christmas moment will be a source of joy as we gaze on our constantly bickering children for one shining moment in the year. Maybe they'll get along. Oh. And then he went to open it. Every moment of his opening was like a knife slice. It was agonizing for me. The bow, the Christmas paper, it just seemed to take forever. And then he unpried the box. And to add insult to injury, I didn't just leave the gift of nothing in the box. I'd put a random old orange juice top inside a small weird piece of trash that I'd found on the counter. I just tossed it in to say, "He'll, there you go," you know. And so my shame was immediate as their confused faces started to register the fact that I had gone through such an underhanded process. There was a sadness in the moment, and then the shame was immediate. I'd purposely given my brother a sham present. It seems that going on the most joyful day of the year, I was harboring my ill feelings. But in my empathy for myself at this young age, I look back and I see that motivation and my desire to return that hurt that I was so often feeling from my brother to him. It seemed opportune, right? That one day when everything was lined up, and to have it be the most painful. But I soon learned in those moments as he was doing that, and even as I retell the story, the pain that is revealed in me, still a bit shamed about what I chose to do. That we learn that retaliating does the opposite of helping to make us feel good so much of the time, doesn't it? I was never going to be a skillful adversary to my brother's antics. And importantly, I learned along the way that my attempts at retaliation, as valiant as they might be, would not support my own health or healing. I tried to defend myself, but to reverse an act underhanded left me never feeling triumphant, even as hurt as I may have been. There is that self-preservation. Perhaps we can all think of situations in which we have received injustice and we have been on the other side of bullying. But have we ever felt wholly well when it is that we can stick it back to the person and put it back in their face? What are the other means of collaboration and truth-telling and means of working together with nonviolence that might be, in the end, more effective? And we know that in the Jacob story, as we'll hear from next week, and I know as it goes on, that thankfully there is a way that these brothers find themselves back together, but not before Jacob goes in this way and through his own sense of injustice continues to trick his brother. For Esau, for Bob, that meal today was well wrapped, right? It had all the trappings of what seemed like a good thing, but that stew itself, it may have been a momentary satiating of that hunger, but it was a gift given not with blessing, but with harm. I don't know the record going on Jacob's head about who he was or was not the second child in this incident prior. I know that his mother, Rebecca, as we wanted to illustrate today, because she gets such a small part in the scripture itself, but we're told that she's the undermine. We wanted Mary Jane to really bring out that sense that Jacob was fed into this feeling, not just on his own. I imagine that there are many days of plotting that have begun, even before this one, to form the feeding sense of what he must deserve. Not only this plot, but the deceptive plot that follows in the later text, stealing of a blessing from a blind man, the birthright right under Isaac's nose. Notice how feelings of injustice and jealousy can be a major motivator in our seeking to harm another. And I've lived out that every day of my life with my children in my house. Because you think, oh, well, I will then have children that really get along. And at 2.5 years apart with Phoebe and Jay, they are beautiful and wonderfully made, and they are vastly different in their temperaments. And one might want to poke at the other, and the one will come back and poke again. And so I give myself over to the reality that there are not perfect children, just perfect ways of meeting them in the midst of all the ups and downs and imperfections that we all face as family. And all those things that we nurse, all those ills, they stick with us. And the more that we don't go about the inner work of helping to heal those, the more that they create a residue. And they really color how it is that we are able to be open to one another and to love deeply. Now, we can see this all the way around in our world today. We know that it was a metaphor, too, of the two babies in the womb that were at war as a symbol of the nations of Israel and Edom that would later be continuing to be at each other's throats. So we needed an explanation about how this came about and the origin story. And we see that today in so many places in our world when factions come and these grudges continue and continue, a recipe for ongoing disaster. When we're vying for resources, when it is that we think we can get what we need, and certainly as climate begins to change, continues to change, and there is a vast need for the resources that are in short supply. I believe, friends, as we look out into this eco-trauma and all the traumas we hold in ourselves, that it starts with us. It starts individually of doing an inventory, looking at our current recipes for how we're choosing to live our lives, how ultimately we're doing that together as a family.